Good morning, everybody. Stand with us and worship with us this morning.
You can be seated. Thank you, Ben. It's great to see everyone today. And you know, when I do announcements, I want you to work with me. I want you to participate. So, with your very best, glad I'm not in Walmart, smile, would you just turn around and tell somebody, it's good to see you in church today. Pastor Phelps, First Lady Phelps, good to see you in church today. Good to see you. Good to see you. We are the, good to see you, Dad. We are the church, but it just so happens that today we're gathered here at Union Point Church. So it's good to see you in the Lord's house today. Welcome. The mission of Union Point Church is very simple, and it is taken from John chapter 12, where Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all people to myself. So we are lifting up Jesus and lifting others. And that's what this mission is about. And the mission keeps going because of your giving, your support. Helps to further the kingdom, keep things going. You can give on the app. You can give online using the app. You can give in the giving boxes in the back. A lot of ways to give. Speaking of the app, on the app, you can check out current sermon content, past sermon content, and just a good way to keep up with what's going on through the app. And somebody at the tent can probably tell you how to download it, maybe, or your 8-year-old grandchild could. But stop by the tent if this is your first time with us. Stop by. We've got a nice gift bag and a coffee mug. All the cool kids have the coffee mug, so you need one. So stop by and get one of those on your way out today. By way of announcement, the exchange tonight, Jordan, give me a wave over here, brother. Jordan and his team doing an awesome job with that. Middle school, 6 to 7, that's their time slot. Middle school, 6 to 7. High school, 6:30 to 7:45. So make sure your young person is a part of that. You'll be thankful that you get them involved. The moms, all the moms. Matter of fact, we ought to give all the moms in here, it's not Mother's Day, but give all the moms a comedian once joked, he said that if evolution were true, moms would have 12 arms by now. If they were adapting. Anywho, moms group, first and third Tuesday of every month, and this is starting Tuesday, September the 20th. And for more details, you can see the folks at the tent or check it out online. Men's retreat, November 17 through 20. I'm assuming there are a few spots left open. Blake, a few spots left open. Thumbs up. Sign up for that. Get a bunch of men together and love on one another, love on Jesus, and eat good. Sign up for that if you want to. Just want to share, I'll share the same thought that I had with the first service. I shared this with the fishing tournament guys. Where are my fishing tournament guys? Thank you all for that big gift to Union Point East. But I keep going back to this, and I felt like maybe it'd be good for us today. How many of you know that a lot of times in church we kind of fake it? I faked it before. How about that? Let me just say I faked it. We like to act like we're okay. I hope Charlie uses the same illustration. We like to think we're okay. You know, we're good in church. How you doing, brother? God bless you. Yes. Yeah. How you doing? Highly favored. Blessed of the Lord. Glory to God. Jesus appeared to the disciples in John chapter 21. And I love this. I never really considered it. They've been following Jesus, and it seems like it's really not working out that great, you know? The guy you've been following, watching feed 5,000, heal people, and now they've killed him, crucified him. And then he shows up, and then he's gone again, you know? He's been raised from the dead, now he's gone again. What's this about? And Peter, he throws his hands up and he says, I'm going fishing. And we're not talking about recreational fishing. We're talking about, this was a commercial fisherman, and he says, I'm going back fishing. If you've been in Sunday school or church, anybody remember how much they caught? They went back, and all the other disciples said, we're going with you, Peter. And they go fishing, and they fished all night. Anybody remember what they caught? Yeah, nothing. But here's what blew my mind about that. This is the third time Jesus showed himself to the disciples. And he yells at them from the shore. Children, have you caught anything? This is what I love about the Bible. It shows us people being people, just like you're people, and I'm people. And their answer is so, it's a complete sentence, but it's so honest. They simply yell back to the man on the shore, no. Maybe you'd seen this before, but I had never realized that this was men who are professionals at what they're doing. They're discouraged, they're disgusted, they're defeated, they're disillusioned by this whole Jesus thing. And when they fished all night and they haven't caught anything, and they are bold enough to be honest with the man on the shore. No. I don't know how you are, but I just ain't going to yell back, no, that I haven't caught anything. I'm going to say, we're fixing to. Because we've been seeing them all around the boat. We're fixing to catch some. We haven't caught any yet, but we are fixing to catch some. I'm going to say something like, well, we caught a few, but they were so little, we just threw them back. I'm going to say, we caught some here last week. You should have been here. I'm not just going to be down and in the gutter and say, no, we haven't caught anything. We've toiled all night. Nothing. But you know, when we come to church, it's okay. Jonathan, you got it all together? No. Oh, man, I wish I had some real people in here. I hope Charlie just goes down that say, hey, everything great in your life? No. Oh, man, I wish I had one witness that would not leave me up here by myself. Yeah, how you doing? Everything, is everything perfect with you? No. But there is one that everything is perfect with, and his name is Jesus. And we can come to him and tell him everything. This book of Hebrews, he's not a high priest that's not touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He knows what you're going through. So we can be honest with him. So today as we worship, just give everything to Jesus. In the singing, as we hear the word going forth, Charlie's got a good word for you today, man. You need to have your listening ears on. But let's pray to this God that loves us. That one that's on the shore of our lives asking us how we're doing. Let's be honest with him. Lord Jesus, we love you today. And we're so thankful that you know exactly where we are. You know exactly what we're going through, each one of us individually. And Lord, I just pray that you would help us to lose ourselves and abandon to you today, to your will, to your grace, to your mercy. And let us love you with our whole being, Lord, mind, soul, spirit, body, in a reckless abandon to you today. In Jesus' name we pray.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no you open up my eyes in wonder.
Thank you, guys. That was awesome. How about that message? I am redeemed. You set me free. That's good stuff. That's very good stuff. It's good to see you guys this morning. First service, didn't realize just how much I had to lob off of my sermon for going too long. As far as they're concerned, I was right on time. But hey, we're in the last service, so I've got you to at least 2, right? All right, 1:30. I don't know if everybody agrees with that, but we'll go with it. Well, we are in the book of Hebrews, and if you want to know a book that's got some really incredibly deep theological concepts and meaning to it, Hebrews is your book. I actually would think that when it comes to Christology, I would place the book of Hebrews over the book of Romans. And I love the book of Romans. And if you really want to know all about the Christian faith, Romans is a book, but do not discount Hebrews. And it's an interesting thing about Hebrews, because did you know that, Hebrews could have possibly not made it in the New Testament at all? One of the things that's so awesome about the canon of Scripture that you have and I have is that it was not delivered to us the way it is today from the top down. There was no decree from an emperor or a council or a group of high up dudes that said, here's what's in there and here's what's not in there. Now, that doesn't mean that that sort of activity didn't go on, but what you see if you study how the Bible was compiled is that it was not a top-down approach. It was a bottoms-up approach. These people wrote letters. They passed it around churches. It got disseminated all over the place. It was uncontrollable. You know, how do you stop the letter that Paul wrote to the Romans once it's already out there? You can't. And so if you really wanted a good word to describe how we got the canon of Scripture that we have today, I would say it's God's providence. What we have is exactly what He intended for us to have. No more, no less. Now, that doesn't mean that a lot of other books that didn't make it into the canon aren't any good. There's several that are orthodox and they're good and they may even be a little inspirational if you wanted to read them. They just didn't make the cut. Why? I don't know. Hebrews is one of those that almost didn't make it. Now, why is that? Well, they had a criteria that sort of changed over time, but the early church was sort of like, well, one of the criteria is authorship. We need to know who the author is. You didn't know who the author of Hebrews was. Some thought it was Paul. But if you read Hebrews, you're thinking, well, if Paul wrote this, why would he say this or that? There were some problems with that. So maybe it was a student of Paul's, and it could have been. But that is the reason why it almost didn't make it in. You know, so they had these different categories of letters for the New Testament. There were the ones that were indisputable. Nobody had any arguments about it. And guess what was indisputable? The four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There were others, like all of Paul's letters. There were some that were sort of like iffy. A lot of people liked them and included it into their Bible, but some didn't. Like 2 Peter, Jude, Revelation. You'd be surprised. 2 and 3 John. These were all kind of iffy to them. And Hebrews was one of those. There was nothing wrong with them theologically. So there was that second class of books that Hebrews fell in. But we wound up with Hebrews in there. And thank the Lord that we have Hebrews because it is so rich. And by the time you get to the later days in the church where they're trying to wrestle with the big questions about Jesus' nature or things of that, you've already got the canon. It's already there. All you have to do is go back and look at the biblical data. What does it say about Jesus? What's his nature? What's God's nature? Is there a Trinity? Or all of that was already there, ready for them to study and to interpret and come up with the verities of the faith that we have. So, thank the Lord that we have Hebrews. The thing is that Hebrews is not an easy book to read. One of the things that the author of Hebrews himself gets into, and we'll discuss this, is how some of the concepts are a little more advanced than others. And we'll discuss how that is. So before we get started in that, why don't I go ahead and read it? Because it's going to take me probably 5 minutes to get through this, because we're starting with the end of chapter 1, verse 14, and reading throughout the rest of chapter 2. So let's go ahead and begin. Beginning in chapter 1, verse 14. Are they not all spirits engaged in special service? Talking about the angels here. Sent on assignment for the sake of those who are going to inherit salvation. In other words, they're servants for us. Because of this, it is all the more necessary that we pay attention to the things that we have heard, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels was binding, and every transgression and act of disobedience received a just penalty, how will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which had its beginning when it was spoken through the Lord and was confirmed to us through those who heard? While God was testifying at the same time by signs and wonders and various miracles and distributions of the Holy Spirit according to his will. For he did not subject to angels the world to come about which we are speaking. But someone testified somewhere saying, what is man that you remember him, or the son of man that you care for him? You made him for a short time lower than the angels and crowned him with glory and honor, and you subjected all things under his feet. Psalm chapter 8, verses 4 through 6. For in subjecting all things, he left nothing that was not subject to him. But now we do not yet see all things subjected to him. But we see Jesus, for a short time, made lower than the angels. Excuse me. Because of the suffering and death crowned with glory and honor, so that apart from God's might, or because of God's grace, depending on transcripts, it could say both, he might taste death on behalf of everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things and through whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the originator of their salvation through sufferings. For both the one who sanctifies and the ones who are sanctified are all from one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brothers, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing in praise of you. And again, I will trust him. And again, behold, I and the children God has given me. Therefore, since the children share in blood and flesh, he also, in like manner, shared in these same things, in order that through death he could destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and could set free these who, through fear of death, were subject to slavery throughout all their lives. For surely he is not concerned with angels, but he is concerned with the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, he was obligated to be made just like his brothers in all respects, in order that he could become a merciful and faithful high priest in the things related to God, in order to make atonement for the sins of the people. For in that which he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are tempted. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, who lived the life we should have lived and died the death we should have died, in order to free us from all of the chains that we carry around with us through this life. And the biggest one and the heaviest one is death itself. I just ask that you be with me this morning as we go through your word. Guard my mind, my heart, my mouth. Speak the words that you would have me speak, and no more, no less. And Father, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So, the first thing that the author of Hebrews is issuing here is a warning. And you're going to see this warning pop up throughout the rest of the letter to the Hebrews. And the first warning we're here is not to drift away, not to neglect the great salvation that we have. Now, I know that sometimes we go too far when we come to our eternal security, all right? I'm a Southern Baptist background. I know all about eternal security. And sometimes they have the unfortunate phrase, once saved, always saved. Well, the problem with all that is that if it were impossible for us to drift away from this faith that we have, why would he even bother warning us about it? He goes overboard to warn us over and over and over again. But what is he warning us? Not to drift away from what? Not works, not avoiding sins. It's don't drift away from your belief. You cannot earn God's acceptance. Those are dead works. It's impossible. You are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone. You cannot lose by demerit what you never earned from merit in the first place. Can we get that out of the way? You don't lose your salvation like you lose your cufflinks or your car keys. All right? Whoops, it's gone. I guess I lost it. It don't work that way. Here's the question, though. Can you chuck it? Can you throw it away? Can you walk away? Well, according to the author of Hebrews, it's at least possible enough to warn you not to. Okay? That's a whole different thing. Now, whether or not the people that walk away, were they ever saved in the first place? That's all I'm going to leave to God's mind, not mine, okay? I'm going to deal with human beings the way I know human beings right here, just the way he does, and just say, hey, don't do it. Don't drift. So what does he say? All the more necessary that we pay attention to the things we've heard. Well, what did they hear? Well, they heard about the person and work of Jesus Christ. And they also, and you see in chapter 1, that Jesus Christ is the exact radiance of God. The word radiance is apogasma. It's only used one time in the New Testament. You couldn't get an identity more closely related to God than using that word as it relates to Jesus Christ. Jesus is God. Okay? You can't get any clearer than that. If somebody tells you that nowhere in the New Testament is Jesus ever declared God, that's something that was developed later, point them right back here. Point them to the Gospels where Jesus puts himself in the place of God. No one knows the Son but the Father, and no one knows the Father but the Son and those who the Son chooses to reveal him. No one says that except deity. When he refers to himself to the Sanhedrin as the Son of Man, he's referring back to Daniel chapter 7 where you have the Ancient of Days and the Son of Man come together, and the Ancient of Days hands the kingdom to the Son of Man that's eternal. No, and can never be destroyed. That's deity. He's referring to himself as deity. Before Abraham was, I am. I don't care where you go. Jesus has declared God all throughout the New Testament. It was not a development. But what else did they hear? There's a hope. There's a future. Because of what Jesus had done on our behalf, he sits at the right hand of the Father, and he's secured for us a future that if you knew about it, if you could just get a glimpse of it, it'd blow your mind. It would absolutely blow your mind. And here's the thing. It's not playing a harp sitting on a cloud. And it ain't wearing choir robes and singing Just As I Am for the 75th billionth time. I'm telling you, I don't want to be overly critical, but when I hear that's what the heaven is, I get a sinking feeling. I'm like, this sounds really boring to me. I don't think we have to worry about boredom in the life that's been secured for us. We are not going to be passive. We're going to be active and ruling and reigning with him. And there's nothing boring about that. There isn't any such concept as boredom in the kingdom of God. So, having put that aside, this hope, they heard. They heard it directly from those who heard from the apostles themselves, and that they originated from the Lord. And at the same time, even though they weren't there to see Jesus, they were seeing the results of it. That the Holy Spirit that was performing miracles and was distributing gifts of the Holy Spirit to people. It was undeniable about this message that they heard. So why would they drift? Why would you walk away from that once you knew it? Well, it's not because you just forgot it, okay? But there are several reasons, and I think that in the text that we can kind of pull them out. So the first one I want to get to, we can skip the next one that says a constant reminder. We just covered that and go straight to the gospel is superior to Torah on the slides. I'm not really crazy about the slide titles that I came up with. I could have done a better job. But anyway, you'll get the message here. What was one of the first things? Well, let's look here. It says, for if the word spoken through angels was binding and every transgression and act of disobedience received a just penalty, how will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation which had its beginning when it was spoken through the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard while God was testifying at the same time by signs and wonders and various miracles and distributions of the Holy Spirit according to his will. What a run-on sentence that is. But you get it. He's speaking to Hebrews. These people grew up with Torah. They grew up with synagogue. They know their Torah. They know their prophets. They know all that stuff. They knew the Torah was a super important binding document between God and his people. What he's saying here, first off, is that the gospel is superior to the Torah. There is no message of salvation. There is no gospel from just reading the law, the Torah. There's a connection to it, there's no doubt about it. But the Torah can't save you. What does Paul say that the Torah does? Drives you to the feet of Jesus. You know, 1 Corinthians 15:55 says this, and we'll get into this whole concept of death and slavery, but the power of death is sin, and the power of sin is Torah. Well, how come? Well, if you go to Romans 7, he tells you why. He says, I already had all this badness within me, but all I needed was the law to tell me this badness was in me, and you think that got rid of it? No, it made it worse, particularly in pretending that I didn't have it, which is what that is. It's like a vicious cycle. The law condemns. The law's not bad, as Paul would say. I am. So the power of death is sin. Romans 5:12 is that through one man, sin entered the world, and death through sin, and all die because all what? All sinned. You see that pattern? You can't ignore this, the message of the gospel. How could you? You have God who comes down in incarnation as a man who lives and dies and is raised again so that we never have to face death and that we can rule and reign with him. What's plan B for you? Well, I'll tell you what it is. Falling back on what's familiar, what you already know. Torah, synagogue, festivals and high feasts, etc., etc., etc. I know that. It's real familiar to me. I'm talking as a first century Jew. Imagine yourself as a Christian Jew going to synagogue. How hard would that be? Here you are believing in Jesus as Lord. He's God. Going to synagogue with people that don't believe that. How does that mesh? Well, Jesus says that they'll throw you out of the synagogues in my name or because of my name. It's not easy. They did not have an easy row to hoe. So what would make it easy? Walk away, drift. Okay, I know that I can stay in my synagogue and I can keep all my friends and all my family if I just walk away from this. That's what he's talking about. So there is a way to drift from that standpoint. The pressure that they had, the pressures that they felt from their own peers and from their own religious backgrounds to pull away from just Jesus Christ and his gospel was hard, and it's a struggle. Because, folks, following Jesus is not a picnic. It's life. It's the message of salvation, but in this world, it ain't easy. I don't know how many times that I've wanted to just walk away and chuck it. I'll tell you that, honestly. And if you guys said that you didn't, I ain't buying a car from you. It's not easy. It's a struggle. It's perseverance. But there's a second thing. First of all, we talk about angels all throughout chapters 1 and 2. What is it with all the angel talk? All right, have you ever wondered that in Hebrews? Well, there's lots of possibilities, but there's one thing that stands out to me is that even though these people were in synagogue, they were Jewish, they were also in the diaspora. They were in Corinth, they were in Rome, they were in Ephesus. And they were living in a Greco-Roman culture. And there was a common thought process that the culture in that time embraced. Nerdy philosophy folks would call it Neoplatonism. They have a name for it now. In a lot of ways, it's kind of has some spooky familiarness to the Bible, but it's not. It's not scriptural. It's not in the message of salvation. But it's a Greek philosophy. But it was so popular that it sort of imbued its way all throughout the culture. And one of the things about Neoplatonism is that they have these things called emanations. And I won't get into the details of it. But it's to separate this evil, bad material world that we're living in from the perfect God at the top. And that our souls, which are not matter, are not a part of this evil material world, want to get back to there. And then there's a whole philosophy on how you do that. Now, there are some familiar concepts with that, right? Well, these things, these emanations that stand between our bad, evil, material world, which is not evil, by the way, from a scriptural standpoint. It's marred, yes, but it's not evil. These things that stand in between God and us, these emanations, geez, they sound a lot like angels to me. So wouldn't it be easy if I was just kind of roll with the flow in Corinth to sort of embrace this idea that they embrace in Neoplatonism, but I'll just call them angels? As a matter of fact, I can even tell them, hey, our synagogue, we talk about angels in there too. If you want to come into our synagogue, well, we're not that much different than you. There's a syncretism here between Judaism and Neoplatonism in that culture and in that day and age that made it easier. It made it easy for you as a Jew to deal with your culture, Greco-Roman culture, by doing things like that. But it meant drifting away from Scripture. Okay? They do all those things to try to make life easier, and they want their cake and eat it too. But what they don't understand and what the author of Hebrews is going to get at is that suffering is a good thing for you as a Christian. Jesus suffered. There's purification through suffering. There's maturity through suffering. If you don't suffer, you don't grow. You're avoiding the one thing that's inevitable if you want to remain loyal to Jesus, and the one thing that's going to help you become a mature spiritual person in the name of Jesus. So they were, and it's not that they're the only ones. Can't you see in our own age how that would apply to us too? How easy it is for us to walk away from the hard parts that a lot of folks don't accept and just to get along, like family, Thanksgiving. Okay, you know, maybe you're right, maybe I'm not right, whatever. It's easy to do that, to avoid all that. It makes life easier. So the warning is for us as buzz it was for them. Stand firm. Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. It's okay to suffer too. It's okay to deal with that. As a matter of fact, the disciples were celebrating that whenever they were beat up because they got a chance to suffer for Jesus. I don't know if I'd do that, but maybe I should. There's something on the other side of staying with that. And what the author of Hebrews gets into later is that it grows you. You become mature. And here's the thing we have a problem with is that the church is always trying to avoid, and it's not just churches, it's American culture. There's a spirit of anti-intellectualism, as if there's a schism or a chasm between spiritual things and intellectual things. When spiritual things are intellectual, and intellectual things are spiritual. There's no dichotomy between those things. But what we want to do is keep it simple, stupid. All right? So we focus what? On the minimum entrance requirements. Forgiveness of sins, heaven when you die. There you go. Don't worry about all these other concepts like Jesus being all God and all man. What the author of Hebrews is telling his audience then, you're not going to grow. You guys are dull in hearing and you're babies. I can't tell you the things that I want to tell you because you're still spiritual babies. Whenever you deal and wrestle with these difficult concepts, and there are difficult concepts in life, not just in the Bible, you have to deal with them. Just people that do their own tax returns. Is that simple? You can't avoid it. But here's the thing, is the complicated things in Scripture, the complicated things that the author of Hebrews is trying to teach these people, and us, is that if you handle the complicated stuff that he wants to teach you, you wrestle with that stuff through his word and through the discernment of the Holy Spirit, you grow. He doesn't leave you where he found you. He wants to raise you and continue. Salvation is not an event that you prayed a prayer 20 years ago. Punch the ticket. Thank you. Don't work that way. He never wants to leave you where he found you, but he's not going to erode or usurp himself over your freedom. If you want to slip away, he's going to respect your free choice to do that. Now, through his sovereignty, he may not let you go very far. There's parts to that that are a mystery. God's sovereign, we're responsible. How do you reconcile them? I don't know. Nobody knows, okay? So let's just put that aside and just deal with the fact that we can drift, and we can fall back into what's familiar. But what is it that we're drifting away from? So that's what he deals with next. Let's start in verse 5. For he did not subject to angels the world to come, about which we are speaking, but someone testified somewhere saying, what is man that you remember him, son of man, that you care for him? You made him for a short time lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor. You subjected all things under his feet. It's taking that from Psalm chapter 8, verse 4 through 6, which is not a messianic psalm. It's just about humans. What is it about human beings that you like us so much and you made us the way you made us? But what Jesus is saying, what this is saying is that this also applies to Jesus. And he is our perfect substitute. He's the perfect human. So they've taken a non-messianic psalm that applied to just humans, and they're applying it to Jesus right here. For in subjecting all things, he left nothing that was not subject to him. Okay, that psalm says that everything should be subject to us. What did God say in Genesis 1, right? Go forth and be fruitful and multiply and take dominion over all the animals in the field, the birds in the air, and the fish in the sea. Well, what would that mean to people like us in our day? Take dominion over your IP network. Take dominion over your office. Take dominion over your home. Take dominion over your friendships and everything. We have different things. We don't necessarily have sheep, right? Some of you might. But it's the same concept. You have your kingdoms, and you're actually going out with the edict that God gave us to extend Eden to the world, all right? That's what our job was. We failed at that. We rebelled against God. We thought we knew better. And so here comes Jesus, which is God incarnate, that actually fulfills that in himself. And that faith in him would give us what we need, basically having his Holy Spirit turning us into sacred space. Paul doesn't call our bodies temples just as a neat metaphor. He means it. We're sacred space. We're sealed with the Holy Spirit. And we can fulfill that mandate. And that mandate is not something that just starts after we die or when Jesus comes back. It starts right now. And the author of Hebrews knew this. You can't separate eternity from the present. The kingdom of God is not yet and already. Does that make sense? If you focus too much on the not yet, then your Christian walk is not going to be too relevant to your life. You're just going to be waiting for the good stuff to happen. If you focus too much on the already, you're going to become a Pharisee. You're going to become self-righteous. Because the only thing that matters is in their important things like justice. But you can see that if without the focus on the future hope and with what Jesus procured for us, it's too easy to get into just how great we are. You have to have a balanced approach on both because both are true. Some of heaven's already here. Some of heaven is experienceable right now. And we may not be able to recognize it until we get there. And then we'll look back and see, oh yeah. So it was already starting way back then. Yes. But what's the purpose of that? To continue that mandate. But not everything is subject. Not even to Jesus right now. There are some things that are not subject to Jesus. But they will. Everything. Go to Colossians chapter 1. Even in chapter 1 of Hebrews. Eventually, everything will be subjected to Jesus. He will have procured all of reality. And it'll be all under his feet. All of it. And that is your inheritance and my inheritance. And that was theirs. And what the author of Hebrews is saying is, why? What's your other option? You got a better plan? That's a rhetorical question. For it was fitting for him whom are all things and through whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the originator of their salvation through sufferings. For both the one who sanctifies and the ones who are sanctified are all from one. For which reason he is not ashamed to call them brothers, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers in the midst of the assembly. I will sing praises of you. That's his divine assembly. The one you read in the Old Testament. They all rebelled. We get to fill their roles. This is a divine council scene where he is introducing us as loyal followers of Jesus, as new council members. That's pretty cool. And again, I will trust him. And again, behold, I and the children God has given me. Faith in Jesus makes you the family of God. Faith in Jesus makes you Jesus' brother, and you get to inherit what he already has attained. And we share in that reign and rule with him forever and ever. Heaven is not playing a harp on a cloud. It's not singing "Just As I Am" for the billionth time. It's active. It's vibrant. It's something that even right now, those that have gone before us, they're not sitting around. I really don't believe that. Therefore, since the children share in blood and flesh, he also, in like manner, shared in these things in order that through death he could destroy the one who has the power over death, that is the devil, and would set free those who through fear of death were subject to slavery throughout all their lives. For surely he is not concerned with angels, but he is concerned with the descendants of Abraham. Therefore he was obligated to be made like his brothers in all respects in order that he could become a merciful and faithful high priest in the things relating to God in order to make atonement for sins for all the people. Here's the thing. He became just like you and me so that he understands everything that we're going through. Before the incarnation, that is the one thing you think, well, God knows everything. God does not know our personal experience as fallen creatures, ones that are tempted all the time, every day. They feel lonely. They're hurt. They deal with stuff. That's something a human experiences. And so Jesus took on our humanity and became a servant so that he could know exactly what you're going through right now. If Jesus was not God, he couldn't save you. He doesn't have the power to. But if Jesus was not human, he couldn't be a merciful high priest for you either. He wouldn't know what you're going through. So Jesus is fully God, fully man. And as far as our future is concerned, I tell you, those of you that are into the, who are interested, the Divine Council worldview, the Deuteronomy 32 worldview, really opens up a lot of the weird parts of Scripture that we normally ignore. But it also informs us of what our future looks like. And if you want to know what our future looks like, as rulers and reigners with Jesus, go to Revelation 2:25. This is Jesus talking. Nevertheless, hold fast to what you have until I come. And the one who conquers or overcomes and who keeps my words until the end, I will give him authority over the nations, and he will shepherd them with an iron rod. He will break them into pieces like jars made of clay. He is quoting Psalm chapter 2, which is a messianic psalm, but he's not applying it to himself. He's applying it to you and to me if we just simply believe. It's all. Can you think of anything more exciting? Is there anything in this world that's worth pursuing more than that? I'm waiting. No. There's no excuse to look for another option. So we have only one God-man. Why? You can't defeat death unless you're resurrected. You can't resurrect unless you die, and you can't die unless you're human. And you want to keep it simple, stupid? There you go. God had to become man incarnate. He had to die in order to defeat death. And he did. You are not a body. You have a body. Which leads me to the third one, fear. Slaves to fear of death. Romans 5:12 says that through one man, sin entered the world, and through sin, death, so that all die because all sinned, right? In 1 Corinthians 15:55, he says that the power of death is what? Sin. And what's the power of sin? Torah. Torah was to drive you to the cross because of sin. And the reason we have death is because of sin. Sin is the sting of death. Jesus defeated sin, he defeated death, and he procured for us freedom from fear. Do you realize how much fear constitutes our own individual personalities? Our own mortality drives us to become weird individuals, all right? Now, John did that. I'm going to do it again. Name's Charlie. How are you? Pretty good. Oh, by the way, I have a personal struggle with shame, regret, and my own mortality. Darn glad to meet you. But it's true. Sometimes fear of death just comes out honest and transparent. Go to the first picture. It looks like this. Especially in a post-COVID world. You don't know. I don't know. Am I going to get this disease tomorrow or next week? You know, it's a serious thing, and I'm not going to discount it, but it cripples you. It takes away life that you have, fearing death, which is inevitable anyway. But fear of death doesn't usually always manifest itself as something like this. Go to the next picture. Sometimes fear of death looks like this. This is from Studio 54 back in the heyday. I think half these people are dead. But right now it's YOLO. Now how does this fit into fear of death? It's a distraction. These people are smart enough to know that death is coming. But if we can distract ourselves with things that will take our minds off of it, we can actually maybe even convince ourselves and forget our deaths, and in a way we kind of achieve immortality. So eat, drink, party, for tomorrow we die. And tomorrow you will die, as some of these did. So sometimes, like the weird performance I just gave you, it's like YOLO, you only live once. Well, I think whenever you live like that, you're actually thinking in the back of your mind, I'm going to live forever, I'm going to live forever, I'm going to live forever. And you don't. Sometimes the fear of death looks like this, the next one. Anybody in this room heard of transhumanism? It's science's way to try to cheat death. If we can take computer technology and meld it with human biology, maybe we can cheat death and people can achieve immortality. Take all the memories in my brain and download it into a hard drive so when I die, all my memories are in that hard drive. And you can put me in an automaton, some sort of robot being, and I'll still be here. Well, it works on one false assumption, is that you are nothing more than just a collection of your memories. But you're not. So what happens? At some point, you put so much gadgets into your body, you just die. And what's left over is not you. But this is the lengths that human beings will go to cheat death. And that is because they are slaves. They're not free. They are slaves to fear. If you follow Jesus, you are not a slave to death or fear of death because you're not going to die. How many of you have lost loved ones? You go to the parlor room and you see that shell of a body that once held your mother or your father or your child, and you're thinking how powerful that is to see that happen just right in front of your eyes. Well, they're not there. They're done with that body. They're ready for a new one. You are not a body. You have a body. When you close your eyes to this realm, you will immediately open your eyes to the next realm. If you love Jesus Christ, you will never, ever have to worry about dying. You could tell that to all of your kids and grandkids who, right before you go off to heaven, just say, look, I don't want you guys to be upset or worried. It's going to look spooky having my body all laid out there, but I want you to know I'm not there. I'm gone on. Because I love Jesus. He's procured life for me. I don't have to worry about it, and you don't either. And I know it'll be harder for you than it is for me because you'll still be there looking at my body and my lips all sewn up or whatever. But that ain't me. And that's not my destiny. And it's not your destiny either. We do not have to form our personalities over the fear of death ever again. And that is what makes growing disciples mature. That's what makes growing disciples live. And that's what makes growing disciples become salt and light in a world full of Molotov cocktails and self-righteous people that destroy everything. We are the most confounded species on the planet in the 21st century. How we can tear crap up, sorry for using that word in the pulpit, and think that we're doing something just and good. Let me tell you something, folks. Our concept of justice outside the kingdom of God is just vengeance. Getting even. That's justice outside the kingdom of God. That's not us. That's not who we are. But that's the world that we are reaching. And we can't reach it unless we move on to maturity. So as the band comes up, and we approach the table, I just ask you to pray to yourself one thing. No one's going to admit that they have an idol that's higher than Jesus. No one's going to admit that they place a pastor or a church or an evangelist higher than Jesus. But we do. And when they fall, which they will, because we put them up on a pedestal they don't belong, we blame God and walk away, not realizing that our faith was not in Christ, it was in that guy. Or it could be work. It could be church. Whatever it is, you don't have to worry about worshiping angels, at least most of us. There's still probably some fringes out there that do that. We don't have to worry about that. But we do have to worry about drift, because we think in our minds that it'll be easier if we do it. And it's not. So as you approach the table, you, me, all of us, ask ourselves, where's that weak spot? And Lord, show me where those are. Just by Him showing you, will give you the firmness and the ability to stop and move forward. In God's grace, we will all move forward together as one family. Heavenly Father, thank You for the salvation and the life that You've given us. And we thank You for Your word and all that You've revealed to us through it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. As a friend, and I have lived.
Jesus, we just thank you for being so good to us. God, I just pray that you would go with us this week and help us to be a blessing to someone for your name's sake. In Jesus' name, amen. You all have a wonderful week.